Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. The display news articles along with the page numbers are provided here for your reference. The PDF link of the handwritten notes along with the time stamping of the news analysis is provided in the description box as well as in the comment section for smart mobile users. Now let us start our news analysis. This article is based on CartoSat 3. The syllabus linking of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. The news article mentions that CartoSat 3 of ISRO will be launched at the end of this month. So from the examination point of view, let us discuss few facts related to CartoSat 3. It is a third generation advanced agile satellite. Here agile means able to move quickly and easily. And this satellite will obtain panchromatic and multispectral imagery. Here panchromatic literally means sensitive to all visible colors of the spectrum, and multispectral means operating in several regions of the electromagnetic spectrum. So it has high resolution imaging capability, and this CartoSat 3 will be launched by Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, that is PSLV C-47. And know that PSLV C-47 is the 21st flight of PSLV in XL configuration. The XL variant of PSLV has 6 solid strap-on motors and it has the highest payload capability among other PSLV variants. And this CartoSat 3 will be launched into the Sun synchronous orbit. Sun synchronous orbit means if the position of the Sun with respect to a particular point on the Earth remains same as the satellite which is passing over that point, then the orbit is called as Sun synchronous orbit. And the operational life of CartoSat 3 is 5 years and it is an Earth observation satellite. Know that the Earth observation satellites of ISRO are the largest civilian remote sensing satellite constellation in the world, and it is a thematic series of satellites which supports significant number of applications in the areas of land and water resources, cartography, then also in oceanic and atmospheric studies. The CartoSat series have also application in cartography, which means that the science or practice of drawing maps. So with high resolution imaging capability, these maps will be drawn. And as per the news article, the satellites will able to pick up objects of size of even 25 centimeters from its orbit. And this will make CartoSat 3 images as one of the finest and sharpest images in the world. Now we will see the other payloads of PSLV C-47. And this PSLV C-47 will launch not only CartoSat 3 but also 13 other commercial nano satellites into Sun synchronous orbit. And these 13 commercial nano satellites are from United States of America. Know that PSLV C-47 will carry nano satellites as part of commercial arrangement with New Space India Limited. Remember that New Space India Limited, or in short NSIL, is under the administrative control of Department of Space. And this NSIL is a wholly owned Government of India undertaking, or it can be called as a central public sector enterprise. Therefore, with respect to this news article, we have discussed the importance of the CartoSat 3 and its applications in various fields. With this, we have come to the end of the analysis of this news article, and the displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of this session. Now let us proceed to the next news article. This news article is about the proposed decision to link the Kaveri River and the Gunda River in Tamil Nadu. The news article says that the state government has decided to proceed with the linking project. And also the news article says that the National Water Development Agency is preparing a detailed report for the proposed river linking project. The syllabus linking of the news article is highlighted here for your reference. So in this context, we need to understand some basic information about river linking before going into the news article. As you know that water is an important element for the life, and it is the main input for agriculture. Hence, the optimal utilization of water is necessary. Therefore, with a view to harness the water resources, the then Ministry of Water Resources, and now it is Ministry of Jal Shakti, and the Central Water Commission formulated a plan called National Perspective Plan for Water Resources Development in 1980. And this plan aimed at inter-basin transfer of water from surplus basins to deficit ones, with a view to minimize the regional imbalances and also to utilize the available water resources optimally. The National Perspective Plan has two components, that is Himalayan rivers development, and the second component is peninsular rivers development. Now we will see in case of Himalayan rivers development, it aims at construction of storage reservoirs on the principal tributaries of Ganga and Brahmaputra rivers, along with interlinking of river systems to transfer surplus flows of eastern tributaries of the river Ganga to the west. It also envisages the linking of Brahmaputra and its tributaries with Ganga and Ganga with river Mahanadi. And this is the component of Himalayan rivers development of National Perspective Plan. Now, in case of peninsular rivers development, this component again divided into four major parts. In the first part, it aims at interlinking of Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri rivers, and also building storages at potential sites in these basins. This part involves the transfer of surpluses from Mahanadi and the Godavari to the needy areas in the south through Krishna and Kaveri rivers. Then, in the second part of this component, it aims at interlinking of west flowing rivers, that is north of Mumbai and south of Tapti. Under this scheme, it aims at the construction of storages and interlinking them to transfer surplus water to areas where additional water is needed, and also the scheme provides for taking water supply canal to the metropolitan areas of Mumbai, and it also provides irrigation in the coastal areas of Maharashtra. Then the third part of this second component aims at interlinking of Ken with Chambal. The scheme provides for a water grid for Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh, and also interlinking canal backed system with as many as storages. Then the fourth part of the peninsular rivers development is that diversion of other west flowing rivers. As a part of it, the high rainfall on the western side of the Western Ghats runs down into numerous streams which discharge into the Arabian Sea. And this fourth part aims at construction of an interlinking canal system backed with adequate storages that could be planned to meet all water requirements of Kerala, and also for transfer of some waters towards east to meet the needs of drought affected areas, that is western part of Tamil Nadu. So the first part of peninsular rivers development is the interlinking of Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri rivers. As we have said that this aims to divert the surplus flows of the Mahanadi basin and the Godavari basin to the water short rivers like Krishna, Penna, Kaveri, Vaigai and Gundar basins in south. Note that the Kaveri-Gundar river linking that is mentioned in this news article is part of this linking. Now let us discuss in brief about National Water Development Agency, that is also mentioned in this news article. See, this National Water Development Agency was set up in 1982 by Government of India as a society under Societies Registration Act of 1860 under the Ministry of Jal Shakti. Now we will see the functions of this agency, which includes to carry out detailed survey of possible reservoir sites and feasibility of interlinking under peninsular rivers development and Himalayan rivers development components of the National Perspective Plan. And other functions includes to prepare detailed project report of river linking proposals under the Perspective Plan for water resources development after the concurrence of the concerned states. then other functions like to carry out detailed studies about the quantum of water in various peninsular river systems and Himalayan river systems, which can be transferred to other basins. Now, let us look into the news article again. The article says that more than 3,400 acres of land will have to be acquired in phase 1 to construct a canal under the proposed Kaveri-Gunda river linking project. And this canal will divert the excess water, and this project is expected to give boost to agriculture in the water scarce areas of Tamil Nadu. Therefore, with reference to this article, we have discussed in detail about National Perspective Plan, then National Water Development Agency, and also the proposed interlinking of Kaveri with Gunda river basins. So, the displayed practice prelims question will be discussed at the end of this session. Now, let us proceed to the next news article. This editorial article is based on a recent verdict of the Supreme Court. The verdict was with reference to the matters regarding the insolvency and resolution proceedings of the company called SR Steel. This article mentions that as a result of recent Supreme Court judgment, it has set a precedent in enabling quick and efficient resolution of insolvency and bankruptcy proceedings of the companies. That is why the news article is titled as the precedent. That is, in simple terms, the Supreme Court has set a model for the insolvency and bankruptcy proceedings of the companies. The author calls the recent verdict is a landmark in the short history of insolvency and bankruptcy resolution in India. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this editorial article has been highlighted here for your reference. Now, we'll proceed with the editorial. Now, we'll see some of the recommendations by the author. He mentions some important takeaway points from the recent Supreme Court verdict. One is that the Supreme Court has clarified the important aspects related to insolvency proceedings. This is seen as significant because till the verdict of Supreme Court, these aspects were interpreted differently by various stakeholders. And some of the stakeholders are like National Company Law Tribunal, National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, the insolvency professionals, and the Committee of Creditors, and the party that process to acquire the stressed company, and also others like who are involved in insolvency processes. Now, the recent verdict has given some clarity over these important matters associated with insolvency. And this is special because this will avoid litigations in various judicial forums. When there is a clarity, this will ensure quicker resolution of insolvency proceedings. Recently, one of our regular viewers has commented about to discuss the difference between National Company Law Tribunal and National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. Now, we'll see in brief about these tribunals. The Company Law Tribunal is established based on Section 408 of the Companies Act of 2013, and it is established for the adjudication of corporate civil disputes under two legislations, and they are the Companies Act of 2013 and the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of 2016. And this is the main function of National Company Law Tribunal, and it is a specialist body. Here we are calling it as a specialist body because it has both judicial and technical members. This combination of members and their specialized knowledge will help NCLT in resolving the matters effectively. As a result, NCLT is able to provide PD justice, less expensive justice, and effective justice in the area of commercial or corporate law. Now, we'll see what will happen if one of the parties is not satisfied with the order of NCLT. If a party is not satisfied, then they can move to the appellate tribunal for first appeal. This appellate tribunal is called as the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. See, this National Company Law Appellate Tribunal was constituted under Section 410 of the Companies Act of 2013. Therefore, both NCLT and NCLAT are statutory bodies as they were constituted under an Act of Parliament. And the main function of NCLAT is hearing appeals against the orders of National Company Law Tribunal. Note that it is also the appellate tribunal for hearing the appeals against the orders passed by National Company Law Tribunals under Section 61 of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of 2016. And NCLAT is also the appellate tribunal to hear and dispose appeals against any order on rewarding compensation which is passed by the Competition Commission of India. And these are the some of the aspects with respect to NCLT and NCLAT. Now, let us come to the editorial. See, the Supreme Court has upheld the primacy, that is, it has given upper hand to the financial creditors over operational creditors in the resolution process. The ruling stated that the Committee of Creditors are supreme when it comes to deciding on commercial issues in conformity with law. For example, in case of commercial issues like repayment of liabilities, as per the insolvency resolution, the NCLAT has to give importance to the decisions of Committee of Creditors. Here the decisions have to be taken in conformity with the legal provisions. The author also mentions that these two clarifications of the verdict are sufficient to speed up the resolution processes under IBC Code of 2016. Then the court has also stated that the 330 days time period for the insolvency resolution process is not sacrosanct. That is, the time limit is not applicable when there is some reasonable delay for the resolution process. For example, reasonable delay here could be because of judicial proceedings. Then the court has also given a green signal for the acquisition of Essar Steel by ArcelorMittal. Here, during the acquisition and also under resolution, the ArcelorMittal will give around about 42,000 crores to the financial creditors of Essar Steel. As a result, the financial creditors such as SBI, Punjab National Bank, ICICI Bank and others will receive their due amounts. Once repaid, these amounts will be added as profit in this bank accounts. So, the financial creditors were now assured that their credit will be repaid by the ArcelorMittal. And because of improved insolvency resolution processes in this matter, these banks will be financial creditors for more such companies. And because of the trust in the IBC Code 2016 and as well as the resolution process. Now, the author concludes the editorial by saying that because of all these reasons, this verdict will serve as a useful precedent when it comes to deciding future insolvency and bankruptcy cases. See, the insolvency and bankruptcy process is still young in India and there is still a long way to go, particularly in the matter of recovery percentages. If you take all the cases that have been adjudicated so far, the overall recovery is less than 50%. This has to improve along with quick decision making process so that there is a better investment climate in our country. These are the some of the matters that were discussed in this news article. See, this is a spectacular case in the matter of insolvency and bankruptcy cases in India. Therefore, we request you to know about insolvency, bankruptcy, and what is about IBC code, and who is a resolution professional, what is resolution, and committee of creditors, and who are financial creditors, who are operational creditors, and the recent Supreme Court verdict, and why Supreme Court gave upper hand to the financial creditors over the operational creditors, and what is the issue between Essar Steel and ArcelorMittal. All these things we have discussed in a detailed and much simpler manner in our daily news analysis on 16th November 2019. The link has been given in the description, and we are advising this for those who have not seen the discussion on the ArcelorMittal and Essar Steel case. And for other views, you may use for revision. So, with respect to this news article, we have discussed all details with respect to insolvency and bankruptcy proceedings. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is about the present status and reach of Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. The syllabus linking of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. In this context, let us understand about the Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. Here know that Matru means mother and Vandana means to treat with respect. So, Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana is aimed at treating women with respect during the period of pregnancy and lactation by giving them monetary benefits. And this scheme came into effect on 1st January 2017. Note that the Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana is one of the centrally sponsored scheme and executed by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. See, if the scheme is centrally sector scheme, it means that 100% funding is provided by the central government. And if the scheme is centrally sponsored scheme, the funding is shared between the center and the state governments. In case of Matru Vandana Yojana, the cost sharing ratio between the center and the states and the center and union territories with the legislature is about 60:40. But in case of northeastern states and Himalayan states, it will be in the ratio of 90:10. But in case of union territories without legislature, 100% funding is by the central government. Now, we will see the objective of the program. And this Matru Vandana Yojana aims at providing partial compensation for the wage loss in terms of cash incentive so that the pregnant and lactating woman can take adequate rest before and after delivery of the first living child. And this would result in improved health status among pregnant women and lactating mothers. And this scheme would be implemented through the platform of the existing Anganwadi centers, ASHA and ANM workers. Here note that ASHA means accredited social health activist and ANM means auxiliary nurse and midwife. Now, we'll see the beneficiaries of the program. And here the beneficiaries are all pregnant women and lactating mothers who have their pregnancy on or after 1st January 2017 for their first child in the family. But the scheme excludes pregnant women and lactating mothers who are in regular employment with the central government or the state governments or PSUs, that is public sector units, are those who are receiving of similar benefits under any law for the time being in the force. See, under this scheme, a beneficiary is eligible to receive benefits only once. But in case of miscarriage or stillbirth, the beneficiary would be eligible to claim the remaining installments in the event of any future pregnancy. Here, miscarriage refers to death of fetus during pregnancy, and stillbirth is a baby born with no signs of life at or after 20 weeks of gestation. Now, we'll see the actual benefits that are offered under Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. Under this scheme, as I mentioned, that the beneficiaries receive a cash benefit of about 5000 rupees in 3 installments. Note that the eligible beneficiaries also receive cash incentive under Janani Suraksha Yojana. Know that Janani Suraksha Yojana is 100% centrally sponsored scheme, that is, it is a central sector scheme and it integrates cash assistance with delivery and post-delivery care. Therefore, if you combine Matru Vandana Yojana and Janani Suraksha Yojana, on an average, a woman gets about 6000 rupees in 3 installments. It means that the cash incentive will be transferred to the bank account of the beneficiary in 3 installments. That is, first installment will be received when the woman registers pregnancy within 150 days of pregnancy. Then, second installment can be claimed after 6 months of pregnancy when the beneficiary undergoes at least 1 antenatal checkup. And then, the third installment can be received after childbirth registration and the completion of first cycle of vaccinations. Now we'll see the unique feature of the program, that is, its implementation can be closely monitored by the central and state governments through the Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana Common Application Software. Know that this Common Application Software is a web-based software application that enables tracking the status of each beneficiary under the scheme, and this software is helping in identification of the beneficiaries and also aiming at better implementation of the scheme. Now let us look into the news article. The article says that Matru Vandana Yojana, which aims to support pregnant women and lactating mothers by compensating them for loss of wages during their pregnancy, has been able to reach less than 1/3 of the eligible beneficiaries. As we have discussed that the benefits can be availed by the beneficiaries only after meeting certain conditions, such as early registration of pregnancy and having at least one antenatal checkup and also the registration of childbirth. Now, as per the article, because of these requirements, only about 23% of all births are covered under the scheme, and a mere 14% of all births, that is about 2.7 crores in 2017, received full benefits. This data exposes the implementation levels of the Matru Vandana Yojana. Now, the article says that this data is also consistent with the survey conducted in about 6 states such as Chhattisgarh, Himachal Pradesh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and Odisha. Now, we'll see the reasons for such low coverage. First is that only 50% of pregnant women and 57% of nourishing women surveyed were eligible for the scheme because others did not meet the necessary conditions. And the next reason is about the awareness of the scheme. As per the survey, only about 66% of pregnant women and 69% of nursing women knew about the scheme. About 8% of pregnant women and 23% of nursing mothers received some benefits. This shows that there is an urgent need for higher awareness about the scheme. Then the another reason is that the lengthy procedure to get enrolled. The beneficiaries need to fill a long application form and they need to provide other documents such as mother child protection card and Aadhaar card and also the husband's Aadhaar card and the bank passbook linking with Aadhaar card need to be provided at the time of application form. See, here one of the significant hurdle is that having active bank account with linked Aadhaar number. The other reasons that are mentioned for the low coverage of the scheme is that the requirement to produce the husband's Aadhaar card, as this requirement would exclude single mothers and those who may be staying at their natal homes. So these norms should be relaxed in order to take the program to more eligible beneficiaries. Therefore, with respect to this news article, we have discussed the details of Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana and also the reasons for the low coverage of this Matru Vandana Yojana. So, with this, we have come to the end of the discussion of this topic. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us start our practice prelims question session. Now, consider this question. They have given the 5 pairs, that is satellites with their respective type or application, and you have to choose the correct pairs. First pair is that INSAT, and it is mentioned as navigation satellites. Second pair says that Aryabhatta, which is given as experimental satellite. And the third pair says that CartoSat, and which is a Earth observation satellite. And fourth one is IRNSS, and it is given as space science and exploration. And the last one says that AstroSat, and it is given as communication satellite. Now we'll see that how to deal with this question. For this question, to answer that, you should know about these satellites and their applications to arrive at the correct option. You know that INSAT is an acronym for Indian National Satellite System, and it is one of the largest domestic communication satellite systems in Asia Pacific region, and it was established in 1983 with commissioning of INSAT-1B. So INSAT indicates that it is a communication satellite, but it is given as navigation satellite. So first pair is wrong. Therefore, if first pair is incorrect, you can eliminate options B and D. Now consider the second pair, which says that Aryabhatta is a experimental satellite. You know that Aryabhatta spacecraft is named after the famous Indian astronomer. It was India's first satellite, and it was completely designated and fabricated in India, and it was launched by Soviet rocket in April 1975, and its type and application was experimental in nature. So this pair is correctly matched. Now look at the third pair, which says that Cartosat is a Earth observation satellite. Know that Cartosat and its series is an Earth observation satellite of ISRO, and these are the largest civilian remote sensing satellite constellation in the world, and it is a thematic series of satellites which supports wide range of applications in the areas of land and water resources, including cartography. Here the cartography means the science or practice of drawing maps. So with high resolution imaging capability, here maps can be drawn. Therefore, third pair is correctly matched. To know whether fourth pair is correct or incorrect, you should know about IRNSS, which stands for Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. So it is a navigation satellite system, but in the question it was given as Space Science and Exploration. Therefore, fourth pair is incorrectly matched. Now look at Astrosat, which is the first dedicated Indian astronomy mission which aimed at studying celestial sources in X-ray, optical and UV spectral bands simultaneously. And one of the unique features of Astrosat mission is that it enables the simultaneous multi-wavelength observations of various astronomical objects with a single satellite. So it is a space science and exploration satellite for research in areas like astronomy, astrophysics, planetary and earth sciences. But in the question, it was given as communication satellite. But Astrosat is a space science and exploration satellite. So for this question, only pairs 2 and 3 are correctly matched. Therefore, option C is correct option for this question. Now consider this question, and this question is with respect to National Water Development Agency, and they have given 3 statements, and you have to choose the correct statements from the given quotes. First statement says that the main objective is to carry out detailed survey on the feasibility of interlinking of peninsular rivers and Himalayan rivers under the National Perspective Plan. And second statement says that it is a statutory body. And the third statement says that it functions under the Ministry of Jal Shakti. So in this context, we'll see about National Water Development Agency, which was set up in 1982. Second statement, which says that National Water Development Agency is a statutory body. Second statement is incorrect because it is a society which was registered under Societies Registration Act of 1860. Know that it functions under the Ministry of Jal Shakti. So third statement is correct statement. Now we'll see the functions of National Water Development Agency, which includes to carry out detailed survey of possible reservoir sites and also feasibility of interconnecting under peninsular rivers development and Himalayan rivers development components of the National Perspective Plan. And other functions includes to prepare detailed project report of river linking proposals under National Perspective Plan of Water Resources Development. In addition, the National Water Development Agency also carries out detailed studies about the quantum of water in various peninsular river systems and Himalayan river systems, which can be transferred to other basins. So, first statement, which says that the main objective is to carry out detailed survey on the feasibility of interlinking of peninsular rivers and Himalayan rivers under the National Perspective Plan is correct statement. So for this question, second statement is incorrect and first and third statements are correct statements. Therefore, option B is correct option for this question. consider this question, and this question is with respect to Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana, and they have given the three statements and you have to choose the correct option. Statement 1 says that the main objective is to provide partial compensation for the wage loss in terms of cash incentive to the eligible pregnant and lactating women. See, Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana aims at providing the partial compensation for the wage loss in terms of cash incentive so that the pregnant and lactating women can take adequate rest before and after the delivery of first living child. Here the beneficiaries would receive a cash benefit of about 5000 rupees in 3 installments during the pregnant and post delivery period, and this would result in improved health status among pregnant women and lactating mothers. Therefore, first statement is correct statement. Now look at the second statement. It says that it is a centrally sponsored scheme. Know that Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana is a centrally sponsored scheme, and the cost sharing ratio between the center and the states and the center and union territories with the legislature is in the ratio of 60:40, and in case of northeastern states and Himalayan states it will be in the ratio of 90:10, but in case of union territories without legislature 100% funding is from the central government. Therefore, second statement is also correct statement. Now look at the third statement. It says that it is executed by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. Note that the scheme came into effect on 1st January 2017 and the Ministry of Women and Child Development is the executing ministry of this scheme. So the third statement is also correct. Therefore, for this question, option C is the correct option. With this, we have come to the end of today's news analysis. If you like the video, please do like, comment and share the video, and subscribe to the Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Thank you.